Hello, welcome to 21st Century Learning. I'm Don Thomas. Our guest today is Jonathan Sills, Superintendent of Schools in Bedford, Massachusetts. He's a graduate of Cornell and with a Master's of Education from Harvard. And he has been a teacher and department chairman at the Cathedral School in Boston and also Brookline High School, after which he became the principal of the Bedford High School right here in the local town. So welcome to the program.
Happy
Congratulations
to be here.
On your new position. So to begin with, John, tell us a little bit about the town of Bedford and its public school system.
Sure, Don. So Bedford, as you mentioned, it's a suburb of Boston, population about 14,000. It's made up of primarily middle class and upper middle class folk who largely represent the engineering field. So you'll see there's a real streak of pragmatism in town management and in town policy.
It's kind of a working town, actually.
Bedford, a little different from its surrounding communities, which have a history of being quite well-to-do, you know, is historically a working-class town, and there's still lots of roots there. And Bedford, I think Bedford is very similar to many towns just like it across Massachusetts, but there are a few things that stand out. I think it has a particularly high regard for education, and I'll give you an example of how that gets manifest. After building a new elementary school and renovating a second elementary school and renovating and adding an addition to the middle school, there are four schools in Bedford, two elementaries, a middle school, and a high school. We came to assess the need for a renovation and addition of the high school. And it was in terrible shape, 50 years old, needed new systems, needed new space, driven by demographic change.
And this was just recently.
Yes. And about 6 or 7 years ago, we were in queue with the Massachusetts School Building Authority. And the school building authority put a moratorium on any further construction. The town of Bedford responded incredibly. At town meeting, which is this wonderful democratic institution in Bedford, the citizens voted to go forward with this project based on the building committee and the school committee's assessment that we would get reimbursement eventually from the state, but there was no guarantee. And while the town, it's not that they could afford it, they didn't have those kinds of deep pockets, but it shows the kind of trust they had in their elected officials and in their commitment to education. And so they went forward. Eventually the state did give significant reimbursement and $54 million project went forward. So it's a community that has a tremendous amount of support for education. It's a very well-managed, fiscally well-managed community. We are one of four districts in the Commonwealth that has no fees whatsoever. And again, that's not a reflection of
wealth.
Deep pockets and wealth. It's a reflection of the principled stand that the committee, school committee takes, that education is supposed to be a public responsibility and parents should not have to pay twice. And so they found every means possible to avoid adding fees and to manage the district well.
So talk a little bit about the population of your students.
So the population of our students is a little different at the high school than in the rest of the town. Well, first of all, we have primarily Bedford residents. And there's a considerable socioeconomic diversity in Bedford, not so much racial diversity. All the Bedford schools host a METCO program, and the METCO program is a program that began in Boston, in metropolitan Boston in the 70s, it was an integration-focused program, and still is, to bus students from Boston into suburban communities, both to give students from Boston greater educational opportunities, than they might have had in Boston, and to give the communities that were hosting them the opportunity to have more diverse populations.
And this starts right in the elementary school.
Starts
right?
in kindergarten.
And they come, they
go
stay
all
with
the way up through. The high school, however, differs in that the high school educates the kids as well from Hanscom Air Force Base, which adjoins Bedford and a few of the other towns that Bedford is connected to. And so about 18% of our student population come from Hanscom Air Force Base, which lends a wonderful character to our student population. It allows for a school which is medium size, about 880 kids today, to be very complex, very diverse, that benefits all. But it does bring its challenges, as the kids who come from Hanscom experience a lot of transients. They come to us for 1 year, 2 years.
Now, are these Air Force or Army or
Historically,
both?
They've been primarily Air Force, but in the last several years, the mission of the base has changed, and the base offers housing to the other branches, Army, National Guard. And so there's quite a range of roles and responsibilities, and the kids reflect that as well. As well, we have many kids whose parents are active duty and in places like Afghanistan. And that adds an element of responsibility for all of us as caretakers
sure.
for kids. Yeah. So we're very proud of the richness of our school population. As we work to provide quality education for all kids, we're very cognizant of some of those challenges.
Okay, let's talk a little bit about the mission and some of the, and the core of the offerings and so forth.
Sure. Bedford, the district mission for the Bedford Public Schools is that we will develop students as skillful, resourceful, lifelong learners, able to think critically and creatively, and to be problem solvers and responsible contributors to the global community. And I think that I've seen that kind of phraseology in a lot of strategic plans and
sure.
a lot of mission statements, across the country, really. And I think it's they are very laudable goals.
But very difficult.
What I think is special about Bedford is that that's not a mission statement that we put on a shelf to collect dust. It really informs everything that we do. And that requires a certain kind of deliberateness about instruction and curriculum and assessment, how we structure our programs. Because kids don't automatically become complex thinkers. They don't automatically learn to be resourceful. Actually, if we looked at developmental psychology, kids are automatically very resourceful in their younger years. I think traditional schooling in many ways has worked against those natural inclinations. And so, at the high school, which I'll speak to a little more informedly because that is where I was for the last 12 years until just this year when I became superintendent, the high school faculty was very deliberate in delineating a number of academic learning expectations, such as learning how to perceive, derive meaning from context, or looking at patterns and understanding patterns, learning to make sense of their reading rather than just absorb the reading, and learning how to apply what they learn in one setting in another setting. And after delineating those expectations, the faculty developed instructional experiences for kids to engage in to learn those skills. So in the past, when
they're writing their own curriculum, is that?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
With reference to the state frameworks, but I think in many ways enriching and going beyond that. So the term critical thinking has been in the lexicon in education for many, many years. But for many years it was an add-on. You know, let's have a lesson in critical thinking or you know, here's a critical thinking.
It really is a redundant term because all thinking is by nature critical, right? So,
yes and no. I think there are different characteristics to thinking, and there are kinds of thinking that are not critical, that are very accepting, for example, of surface causes rather than digging to look at root causes of a problem. And so I think we're all thinking by nature, but I think there are different
deep
levels
versus
of
surface maybe sort of thing. Yes, go ahead.
And so what's happened in Bedford is that teachers have designed their instruction with these goals front and center. And they design this using a methodology which is often referred to as understanding by design. It's really just good teaching, but it's a process
is this,
of
Wiggins, is that?
Yes, Wiggins and Mittag. It's a process of identifying learning outcomes first, particularly learning outcomes that are organized around big ideas, essential questions. And we've added in very deliberately identifying these thinking skills, cause and effect, generalizing, summarizing, analyzing, synthesizing, and then designing learning experiences that help kids learn how to do those things and practice them.
But you do have texts, and I mean, so what is the interchange now? Because, I mean, you don't write all of the curriculum, do you? Or maybe you do.
No, well, it depends on the course. So we still use textbooks in physics,
science,
and chemistry, and in biology, in mathematics. Although, and we'll get to this a little later, as we move to a more digital environment, we are writing digital texts mm-hmm. as well. And teachers will supplement those with their own materials. But a textbook is a body of information. And so really what's at issue is how kids engage that body of information. For a long time, teaching was simply about absorbing that information. But if the instructional experiences are about how kids manipulate that information, categorize that information, use that information, then you can use a textbook to derive the information. But the key is what kids then do with that information.
So, John, does this take a certain kind of training? Or, I mean, it seems to me that this is a sort of ideal kind of teaching, but on the other hand, you don't find every teacher who is able to do this. So how do you bring that about?
That's a great question, Donna. I think that, first of all, we've structured the high school around collaborative units of teachers, or units of teachers whose goal primarily is to collaborate in generating these instructional materials and sharing them, kind of lifting each other in the process. But all teachers were given professional development around this design process, mm-hmm. About this kind of approach to curriculum and instruction. And all teachers have been involved in identifying and taking ownership of these learning expectations. So we had a several year period during which committees of teachers were generating these learning expectations, honing them down, and then putting them in rubric form so that they could communicate to students what these abilities looked like in practice, so that students themselves could take some ownership.
And did you head all that by yourself, or did you have consultants, or you know what? How did you bring this about? This, because this seems like a pretty inclusive and broad kind of set of goals to achieve.
Well, we've had a great team. It's a matter of building teamwork within the institution. The thrust comes from years of my own practice, of research, of borrowing great ideas from colleagues. So we did not hire consultants to come in and guide this process. It really was pretty homegrown. But it builds on great work that other people have done. And the key is really respecting the intelligence and creativity of teachers, that they have so much to offer when it's unleashed. And when teachers are able to get outside of their own classrooms and begin to share, so that the lunchroom conversation is no longer, certainly not putting kids down, which was never the culture in Bedford, but the culture in the conversation in the teacher's room is about teaching and learning.
So where do you find these teachers? I mean, and do you look for special kinds of credentials, or how do you go about that, the hiring process?
Sure. I think I'll tell you a little bit about where our teachers come from, but I think the key is the culture that you create that then educates new teachers as they come in. So a new teacher comes into a department
sort of
that's already collaborative in nature, and those teachers can't wait to kind of share with that new person, you know, their learning strategies and the ethos that they've developed within that department. And I'll give you a specific example in a moment. But our teachers come from the wide range of backgrounds. We have teachers who come to us right out of graduate school, and we have teachers who've been educated at our state colleges, and we have teachers who've been educated at Harvard. To me, certainly the quality of their education and background is important. The pedigree is not. I'll never forget working in another school where I was a department head, and we had an opportunity to hire a new teacher, and I created a committee of other teachers. And we had a woman who had done an internship, and she was terrific, and she was from Harvard. And then we went and watched another teacher teaching at her school, and she was from State University. And the person on the committee said, well, you know, why would you buy a Ford when you can have a Cadillac? And I said, well, in this case, the Cadillac is the teacher who came from the State University. She was such a natural. She so intuitively understood teaching and learning about the key being that the kids have to do the work. Teachers do the work to facilitate that process, but learning is a process of using the mind. And so good instruction, you know, engages the kids in using their minds constantly. And so we hired that teacher, and she turned out to be terrific. So our teachers come from all kinds of backgrounds, but we also have teachers that come to us with really interesting practical experience. We have a number of attorneys who've left the law to become teachers, and are wonderful history and social studies teachers, government teachers. We have previous engineers, patent-owning engineers who, left industry after 30 years and teach physics, and so they bring a great authenticity to their work. But the key, again, is creating this collaborative culture and excitement about teaching and learning. So we have in our history department, for example, that's put a real emphasis on being very clear about different kinds of thinking skills, cause and effect, reason, you know, generalization, et cetera. They have the kids create schematics to be able to create symbolic representations of these things, and they embed it in content. You know, we say that we teach thinking using content, and the best way to learn content is for kids to think about it. And that department is so energized that every teacher that comes in just says it's the most exciting environment they've ever been in. And they learn, the teachers give formal workshops in critical thinking. They have committees that work together over the summer. And this is who teachers are, I think, generally.
Sounds like a great place to work. But John, that one of the issues, or the current issues today, is teacher performance and evaluation of teachers by performance, and there's race to the top, you know, and so on and so forth. So how does this impact on the Bedford schools, and what do you do about it?
So Bedford is a race to the top school district. And what that means is that when Massachusetts was chosen, it applied to the federal program to get race to the top monies, and did. Bedford was one of the school districts that agreed to be part and parcel of that process right up front. As a consequence, the Department of Education in Massachusetts has developed a new evaluation tool, and or a whole approach to evaluation, which it was mandated to do to be a race to the top state. And at the core of that is the notion that we should measure student learning, and that teacher evaluation should be tied to student achievement directly, which is part of a movement that is, across the country.
Accountability and so forth.
Referred to as the accountability movement. And I think that that movement has both a good genesis and a bad genesis, a positive and a negative. I think the positive, who can argue that that we shouldn't use student achievement and focus on the data, whether it's standardized tests or whether it's our own assessments, and use that to improve instruction.
'Twas ever thus, really. I mean,
looking at grades,
yes.
I mean, teachers have done that right forever. On the other hand, when that's used as a cudgel to have teachers kind of toe the line, I think it's going to have the opposite effect that's hoped for. But let me tell you, share with you a little bit about how that process works. And what I would say is the more enlightened approach that Massachusetts is taking with regard to this mandate. So Massachusetts has generated a new evaluation system that has two parts. One is that teachers will be evaluated on their professional practice, how well they develop their lesson plans, how well they engage all kids in the lesson, for example.
And is that up to the principal or the department chairs to assess?
It is. But it's based on a rubric that's come out of the state. And each school district has had to decide whether to adopt that language in a contract with their teacher associations, with the unions, or whether to modify that language.
And so which did Bedford do?
Bedford did some minor modifications, but we're piloting it, so we created a committee, a joint committee made up of teachers and union representatives and administrators to make that decision together and then to monitor it as we go along so that we'll make some changes and then kind of readapt and readadopt it in the following September.
And what you're thinking about it, I mean, the assessment, how do you think it's going?
So I think that, let me just back up really quickly. So one thrust is teacher practice directly, mm-hmm. and the other is student achievement. Right? Now, the student achievement piece doesn't actually start formally throughout Massachusetts until next year. But we're piloting it in Bedford.
And is that the MCAS part?
In most states, their version of the MCAS can count up to 50% of teacher evaluation. Again, I think it's enlightened that Massachusetts has said, at most 25% in those subjects where MCAS is taught or where kids are being assessed. So the emphasis is on...
And MCAS for our audience, it means...
MCAS is the Massachusetts State Assessment Program, which has high-stakes testing in language arts, in 10th grade, and mathematics in 10th grade, and science in either 9th or 10th grade. All kids have to pass those in order to get a diploma from
right.
their schools. So, as we move to the Common Core, which is a commonly agreed upon curricular core, which is really quite good and puts a great deal of focus on skill development rather than just
And this is
knowledge.
The Bedford Common Core or the Massachusetts?
No, the National Common Core.
Uh-huh.
There's a National Common
okay.
Curricular Core, which is adopted by the majority of states so far. Massachusetts has adopted it as well. So right now we're putting our focus on the teacher practice piece. But teams of teachers, either a grade level team in third grade or a same subject team in 10th grade, like U.S. history, have designed common or equivalent assessments to measure what we think are the critical learnings. And we're using those assessments and student performance on those assessments as our student achievement data. And the idea is that it should be, for us, we think most useful as an internal mechanism to improve instruction.
And this is all complicated, of course, because it, unlike the U.S. Assessment, No Child Left Behind, there needs to be some consideration of growth, okay, of an individual student. So, I mean, a teacher could get very good marks because she or he brought the student from one level low to another level, rather than just saying everybody has to be at the same level.
Correct. In Massachusetts, the emphasis in the student achievement portion of the evaluation process is on growth. And in fact, Massachusetts has been exempted from the particular No Child Left Behind measurement
the
indices,
average.
And have substituted one that's primarily focused on growth.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, we've implemented this new evaluation system. In many ways, it's not very different from what we've done in Bedford for years, which gets back to your original question. Evaluation, which focuses on teacher growth as its primary role, as a way of encouraging teacher growth, where teachers develop growth plans, identify specific areas where they think they can improve, where their evaluator works with them to help to design a very specific process of improvement and how they can get the support to do that, what professional development to engage in, for example. And then they're evaluated.
Okay, John, so it seems to me, we've talked a little bit beforehand, but you've made some major steps in technology, and maybe you can talk to us about that.
Sure. I'd like to talk about that, and if we get a chance, at another really important piece of what we do in Bedford, which has to do with equity and assuring that all kids are learning at high levels.
Good.
In technology, first of all, we're using digital technology in this evaluation process. All the evaluators have iPads, and we have contracted with a software company to develop tools on the iPad so that teachers can go into classrooms for short, regular observations and check off what they're seeing. And we've designed the
teachers, or
When they're observing teachers, when the evaluators are observing teachers.
But principals. Do you have teachers observing teachers?
Teachers may observe teachers, and there's some teaching observing teachers. They can create an evaluation process designed around that, but that's not been really
right,
the practice
okay.
in Bedford. So we're using pretty sophisticated technology to facilitate the evaluation process. More importantly, we've moved at the high school to a one-to-one technology program, and
which
that
is?
Means that we have put iPads in the hands of all 9th and now 10th graders in the last 2 years.
You give them these iPads, or you lend them?
Well, we lease the iPads, right, and then we give them to the students. They get to take them home, so they have them 24/7. That was a decision, a deliberate decision was made. There was a discussion as to whether we should just have the kids use them in school. But because we see the creative potential in kids and their exploratory natural inclinations, we wanted to put them in their hands beyond the classroom as well. So
when did this take place? Was this recent?
Last year was the beginning of the pilot.
Uh-huh.
This year is the second year, and as is reported in the Globe and the New York Times, this is now a very prevalent movement across the nation, one-to-one. There are states like Maine that are way ahead of Massachusetts, where all kids in the state were given laptops, for example. But what are our goals? To us, technology is a tool. And if it's not enhancing our core mission, then we have no business delving into it. And of course, iPads in every kid's hand is just one of our instructional initiatives over the last 10 years. We have a very clear 10-year plan that we renew every 10 years, trying to look in the crystal ball into technology that's changing by the minute. But We see iPads as beneficial in a number of ways. First of all, for kids who struggle with organization, and there are a lot of kids whose study skills, their frontal lobe development is not where it will be, we hope, struggle with organization and planning. And the technology, which is where kids live, and putting planners, in academic planners, into the technology, we're already seeing benefits in terms of kids not.
So what are these? Are sort of more or less calendars or spreadsheets, or what are they?
It's like a calendar, mm-hmm. where they can put their homework assignments and they can write down what they're going to need to do later. But it's in their hand, and then there's a synchronicity between that and the teacher web pages. Where teachers are creating web pages that have the homework assignments, and kids can go immediately to the web page to find out what they're going to have to do. Many teachers are doing away with paper, and kids just do their assignments on the iPad and then email them to the teacher, which also helps with disorganization. Those backpacks that are filled with crumpled up papers by kids that are not well organized.
So that means that you, instead of textbooks, then in some courses you use the digital equivalent?
So for example, chemistry this year, we're piloting a chemistry textbook that's on the iPad, and it's highly interactive. What these new applications in the textbook field offer that standard hardback textbooks do not is built-in interactivity. So the kids go to a lesson, say in a biology text on osmosis, and they can manipulate the cells and actually kind of do a hands-on learning experience. There's some interesting work being done, and we're working with a group from the Smithsonian Institute for Astrophysics at Harvard, which is theorizing that the proximity of the learning to the eyes and the digital tactile manipulation actually enhances the learning experience. So we're doing some experiments with them, to see if we can play that out. We think it's true, and we're seeing the results for kids.
So give us a module, John, about if you're a history teacher and so forth. So how would you use this in your history class, and what would you do as the teacher, and then what would the students do, and how would that interact between the two?
I'll give a few different examples. Let me give one from math first. There's a program on the internet called Khan Academy, which is a gentleman has created visual lessons in physics, in algebra, in geometry, all the maths and sciences.
Khan, K-A-H-N. Yes, right.
So one of our math teachers who works with kids who have struggled historically with mathematics, he created a competition for them to, beyond their normal lessons and homeworks, that they engage Khan Academy and do practice. And he can see on his own screen which kids are doing that and how often and when they're doing them. And over a period of 6 months, he was watching kids who hated math before, doing math at 6:30 in the morning, doing math at 12 o'clock at night. It was highly engaging and interesting to them.
That's interesting. How does he see what they are doing?
Well, there are programs, like Moodle. There are interactive programs where you can set up a group, which would be his class, mm-hmm. and then there's an interactivity between the teacher and the kids. I don't know how the technology works,
right.
But the teacher can see it and monitor it. One of the things that this technology offers for any classroom, let's say the history classroom, teachers can ask the kids questions, and they write their answers down. And the answers will automatically go to a screen in front of the classroom and be graphed so that, number one, it's immediate feedback and formative assessment, so the teacher knows whether the kids are getting it. Number two, instead of just saying who understands such and such, three kids raise their hand and the other kids get a pass, every kid has to engage the question and think about it. And then the teacher organizes a discussion about why some kids answered and, you know, the other kids did not. And they can look at, you know, how they understand sources and information, et cetera, et cetera. So it's highly interactive.
So, Don, let me give you a couple examples of what the iPad is capable of. One of the things that some of our teachers are doing is what's referred to as flipping the classroom, where they take screencasts of their lectures, and the kids watch the lecture at home, so they're getting the information piece of the lesson at home for homework, and then in class they get to work on their problem sets, they get to work collaboratively, they get to work with the teacher giving advice and guiding the process, and so it's a much more productive use of class time. Another thing that's really fascinating, we're working with a software company on a math program that they're developing and we're piloting, where the curriculum is digital, so there's no textbook, and when they do their math problems at home, they are corrected automatically, and so the teacher doesn't have to spend time grading, but the work that the kids do to do the calculations, et cetera, can be reviewed by the teacher. It can go immediately into a feedback loop to the kids. Parents can see when kids are missing homeworks. And so it's a tremendous efficiency. So again, more teaching time can be spent on higher order learning and more problem solving sets, et cetera, in class. So those are another couple of examples of how powerful this learning tool is.
So what is the opinion of the teachers and the students? I assume that they would like this a lot, but do they?
They do. But they're not. It's not without some challenges. So for example, as all parents know who have kids with computers at home, there's a distraction challenge, which is very real. And kids think that they're multitasking, that they can do their homework while they're on Facebook and while they're on the phone and while they're watching a movie on YouTube. But they're not. They're not learning. They're just going through the motions. It's the exact opposite of the reflective kind of mode of thinking that we're interested in. And so we're grappling with that. You know, there are some parents who've been upset that we've put this tool in their kids' hands and now they're struggling with distraction. So we've been researching that. We've now given parents a way to have more control over the internet connection on the iPad so that they can,
supervise.
And we've allowed teachers to roll this out at their own pace because it's a new environment from them. So there are teachers who are using them in really robust ways, and there are teachers who are just learning to use them. We're connecting with some researchers as well. One woman from a professor from FSU, who is this, and there was an interesting article about this in the Globe recently, who is trying to move assessment in the direction that we've been trying to move assessment, which is to be able to assess things like perseverance and tenacity, high order thinking, critical thinking, resourcefulness. Most standardized tests don't do that. And so what we've done over the years is create performance assessments, you know, essays, projects, exhibitions, kids developing documentaries,
portfolios,
et cetera. But she's working at embedding that in games, in learning games. And she calls it stealth assessment. And we're probably going to do a project with her so that as kids are working in a learning game, there's a game called it's a science game. Hmm. It's Newton's Playground, where the kids, they do on an iPad what our science teachers do in their hallways. So, you know, if you go down the hallways at Bedford High School, you'll see physics teachers with groups of kids building ramps and measuring speed and things like that.
Newton's third law and
right.
So forth.
So here it's on the iPad itself. The kids actually draw the ramps, calculate the angles, do it all on there. And in the meantime, there's a program running behind which is measuring things like resourcefulness and perseverance and how many different solutions they try before they give up. So we're very excited about that because it's in line with what we think is our
formation. No, that sounds great. We're running a little bit short of time now, John. You've been at this a long time, both of us have, and so what's your prognosis for future? I mean, for public education here in the States, what are some of your feelings about it?
Well, I think that the general misunderstanding that America is doing poorly relative to the rest of the world has to do with the failure to disaggregate the data. So I think that schools across the nation, like Bedford, are actually doing very well, and our kids are high performers. Bedford kids were number one in ranked number one in ELA in the MCAS this year, and there are many schools that across the country that are like that. But our low-performing kids, and we find more of that in our urban centers where the resources aren't there and where some long-standing challenges have not been adequately met, continue to be, I think, our biggest challenge. At Bedford, because we have quite a complex population, we are very proactive and very serious about closing the achievement gaps that exist within our own school. And while 83% of the kids in our traditionally underserved populations, African American, low income, special ed, all scored proficient and advanced on the MCAS, which we only take as one small indicator, we don't have enough kids from those groups in our AP courses, in our high level honors courses. And so we've been working very hard at trying to change that. We've created programs that identify kids, encourage them to take risks, and then give them academic support to do so. We call that the Excel program. We've initiated a program this past year and invited other districts and created something called the Tenacity Challenge, which is a team-based academic scholarship competition for Latino and African American kids. And we had 9 high schools, and kids had to come up with a history argument and a literature essay where they had to defend a thesis and a math science quiz bowl. And we had about 12 teams. This year we looked to double that. The whole notion being over the 3 or 4 months leading up to that where teachers volunteered to work with these teams really to build academic capacity and a culture of achievement. So we work hard at those things. And those continue to be the primary challenges in American education. I think that unfortunately, the solutions that have been generated because of those challenges, with a kind of one size fits all, have been really problematic for schools that were already high achieving, and schools having to kind of go through a lot of jump through a lot of hoops that are unnecessary. Not that those schools don't have room to grow. And I think defining achievement around the development of kids as thinkers rather than just being good at AP tests is still something that probably most schools could benefit from. And there's great work that's being done by people like Marzano and all kinds of instructional leaders. But that's getting short shrift in the face of the accountability movement that I think is a more kind of negative perspective on educational change. I think teachers want to grow. I think teachers want to do well by all kids. I think that they need to have collaborative environments built with high expectations and clearly delineated expectations for all kids. And certainly there has to be some accountability. But teachers have to have a chance to own the direction of their schools. If it all comes external, it's just not going to be effective.
That's all the time we have, John. So thank you so much for taking time out of your busy schedule to join us.
Thank you, Don.
And thank you for joining us. I'm Don Thomas, and this is 21st Century Learning.